My name is Per Ödling. Peter, if I fall off here, then you put me back together, etc., in approximately the right shape. I'm a professor at Lund University. I'm from Örnsköldsvik, which is bigger than Storuman, but not tremendously. I have a Swedish father, Finnish mother, Spanish wife, little woman, Austrian children, German dog, Japanese car. So I'm a product of globalization. Why are we here? Do you see? I'll put it over here. You see that? That's called a pyramid. They used to be pyramids. That's the demography of Storuman. Yeah, they're screwed. Their general idea is that the people between here and there are going to take care of all of those and, you know, do other useful things. That's not going to work for very much longer. Also, then you think, aha, yeah, they'll soon die off. News for you, they are immortal. People don't die any longer. So you cannot just hold your breath for 30 years and, like, get rid of them. They're going to be around. So we have to find other strategies. You talk about the industrial revolutions. You can debate if it's four or five. I work a bit with contra-tier wave or long waves or industrial revolutions. They tend to have the same pattern. You spend 20 years building some infrastructure. Then there is 10 years of chaos. Like everything goes to the shitters and new things arrive. And on the other end, there is a new industrial logic and a new lifestyle. I spent most of my adult life building internet infrastructure. Now we're in the chaos. The new industrial logic and the new companies, Facebook, Google, Spotify, all of these, all of the games, etc. Are they building the internet? No, not really. I did that. Could they exist without the internet? No, they cannot. So we are in one of these phases. If you list today the world's biggest companies, the ones that are worth the most, almost all of them are internet-based. So this is a very, very big change. Big. There are some problems with this. If you see, there is some text down here saying that to get to the new lifestyle, to the new golden age, we need new policies. If any of you find out a new policy that have been created to help us, please tell me, because I have not yet found anyone. So far with what we've done, for instance, when we got this, do you remember this pirate copying debate that we had? Young people could get access to digital information, art, culture, everything for free. We could have solved this with, for instance, a cassette skatt, so a sort of a base tax. But we did not. What did we do? We put them into court. So we created a whole generation not believing in society. We are handling this transition in an exceptionally bad way. We used to be better. An example. Many of you have a Volvo. At least driven a Volvo, or at least ridden in a Volvo. Volvo was sold to the Chinese for 7 billion Swedish. Volvo is an example of sort of the old industrial logic. Lots of money, lots of employees, lots of people. How many of you have played Minecraft? Oh, this is an educated audience. That's such a benefit. I'm very pleased. So Minecraft is a Swedish game. Wonderful game, has no real goal. It's a so-called sandbox game. You create worlds, it's very nice. I spent at least 200 hours creating I have a castle on a, yeah, with surrounding water and lots of animals. So it is nice. I also have mines, and you know, so I did a good job. Minecraft is sold for twice as much as Volvo, 14 billion Swedish to the Americans. And it had around 40 employees. You're good at math. You immediately realize if you put 3 zeros after that, it's the same amount per employee. But there are not 3 zeros. This is an example of the new industrial logic, the new industry. It creates immense values, but with very few employees. Instagram, that many of you use, it's a fantastic app, can make any idiot seem like a professional photographer. No offense intended towards the professional photographer over there, but it had 12 employees when it was sold for $1 billion. 12 employees sharing a single coffee room. What if, you know, vinterkräksjukan, so this stomach flu comes, they all go. Is the company gone? No, it's not. It's not, the value is not purely in the employees nowadays. So we have a new situation for some, but not for all. These, you know, digital services, they are amazing, among other things, because they have zero marginal cost. Many of you listen to Spotify. You use Spotify to listen to music, right? Yes. If you listen to twice as much, how many jobs did you create? None, right? But if you recruit, each of you recruit one new customer, how many jobs did you create? None, still. So consumption do not create jobs. I know many national economists. Two I like, the rest I don't like. They are not very good. They created a lot of crisis. What do they say? The solution to every crisis is increase the consumption. We can consume our way out of every crisis. No longer true, right? You can consume as much as you want, no jobs. So something has happened. I come from Örnsköldsvik then. When I was a child, or young, we had three stores selling music, you know, vinyl and later CDs, etc. If you scale that up to Sweden, it should have been around 5,000 people in Sweden selling music. Spotify has around 1,500 employees. It's increasing slowly. They are active in 54 countries, I think. Incredibly big difference. And not only is it rationalization, it's better. You do not longer choose the music you're listening to. It is suggested to you. Sometimes, yes, once a week you choose a song. Otherwise, you listen to music that has been chosen to you because you like it. You listen to music that you would not otherwise have listened to, so it's new for you. So it's not only a rationality, it's a better product. With few people. Okay, you all get this with the digital stuff, that has zero marginal cost. This guy, his name is Robert Falk, he's a friend of mine. We were sitting at home in the garden discussing the other image. Actually drinking the apple jack that you mentioned that you should not mention. But you know, look at me. So we're sitting there discussing this, you know, Spotify and these things. And then he says he works for Volvo Powertrain. He was the global production process manager. He had 8 factories. So he says, but you know, the same things go for my diesels, the engines. And I'm like, what? Yeah, the marginal cost for my diesel engines goes towards zero. I used to work at Saab Scania in Luleå, making engines. And the diesel engine is a pretty big thing. It's like this. It weighs a ton, steel, full of, you know, wires and stuff. The idea, the notion that the marginal cost would go towards zero, is ridiculous. My reaction when he said this was, of course, that the wine was good. I thought he was... It's a reasonable thing to assume, actually. But then he starts talking about his factory in Skövde, which is the best of his 8. He has foundries, so he makes his own engine blocks. He has 2 of them. The old foundry, 250 employees, the new has 7. This is a remarkable difference. And then he says, I can double the production in the new one without hiring number 8. So these 7 people don't do any actual work. I don't know what they do, actually. They probably press some buttons or something. So he has some sort of clock thing that he can just increase, and then it creates more engine blocks per minute than it would otherwise, without cost. I did have some arguments against this. For instance, electricity and stuff like this. And then I discussed steel. because you know it weighs a ton. It's a lot of steel. So I looked into mines. I was working at the Royal Academy of Engineering Sciences, and then I looked into LKAB. You know that this spring, they said that our ambition is to have zero people underground in a mine. If you close your eyes and you envision somebody working in a mine, you will see. Do you mind coming up? Yes. And if it's not too much trouble, take off the sweater. Yes, I know it looks strange. Come here. Yeah, or if you're acrobatic, yes. But you know, Peter may have to fix you up. Yeah. Yeah, this is good. This is good. This works. So you close your mind, you think of your eyes, and you think of somebody working in mind. What do you see? You see a real man. Somebody strong, you know, and with a good chin and a little bit of beard. And this is what you think. It used to be like this, but that's a long, long time ago. If everything is going to be run from the surface, you don't need this any longer, do you? Thank you. we need a modern. There we have one. So, could you there? Yes. No, the one in front of you. Yes, that one. Push her up. Yes, exactly. Come. I went to Kiruna to talk to LKAB 8 years ago. Yeah, you better go here. This is safer, I think. No undressing needed. I went to LKAB and chatted with them, and then 8 years ago, they all had young women running the mine. Every young woman controlled 3 machines. So, you know, they didn't control them because they cannot control 3. So the machines were running themselves, and when needed, the woman would guide the machine with some joystick around corners. Why do they have women? Apparently men scrape the paint off because they this is LKAB's words, not mine. I don't believe in this, but they only had women. So this is what the mine, somebody working in a mine looks today. Not working in a mine, but for a mine. This is the modern mine worker. Thank you. So things have changed. They changed profoundly. If a mine has very little staff, the iron is also, it costs an enormous amount of money to make the mine, but once you have the mine, the extra ton to make, since you have almost no staff, is very cheap. So the cost model is changing slowly. This is again Volvo Powertrain. This is the Indian engine factory. And then typically you would say, they've gone to India because the salaries are so low. How many salaries do you see? There's not a lot of salaries, are there? If you look very carefully, there's actually a guy here. Right? If you look even more carefully, you see that all the robots are turned outward. A journalist comes with a photographer and says, we make a reportage, we'll make an interview. The photographer says, we have to make a photograph. I cannot take a photograph without a person because that's their training. It doesn't get good. So this guy, who is actually here in a control room, Facebooking all day, has to stop the whole factory, climb out, put the head in the chassis, and is like, take the photo. Have you taken the photo? Nobody puts a factory in India because of low salaries. This is 20 years ago. We've been talking about the reindustrialization of Europe for at least 15 years. We move factories back because salaries don't matter any longer. Robert went through his Russian factory, which is the newest, and he sorted people according to their educational level. So you have secretaries, you have economists, you have people that clean. He had more PhDs in mathematics than any other category. Where do the PhDs in mathematics work? Or is it the CEO? No. They work here. The blue collar workers have PhDs in mathematics. When I was young in Örnsköldsvik, the backup plan for me and everybody else was to get a job at the local factory. We had Hägglunds and we had Modo. I come from the Modo side. My father was a welder for Modo. You know, Stefan Löfven, our prime minister, was a welder for the Hägglunds side. So he's a bit, that's better. So that's sort of higher status than me. That was the backup plan at the time. Today, to get a job in a factory, you need a PhD in mathematics. It's a big, big difference, eh? You see it here. Productivity development since the 70s. Look at Sweden. It took off, say, 1980. From 1980 today, until today, we've doubled the productivity. This is the economy in average. Since I'm half Finnish, I show you Finland, since 70, it's been tripled. Finland is a bit better. Not only here, right? China, look at the scale, a factor of 25. A productivity increase with a factor of 25. That's a lot. And even India, with its service-heavy economy, is experiencing the same thing. Of course, it's not completely evenly distributed between different industries. The top industry is manufacturing. Modo, Hägglunds, the Örnsköldsvik is a very heavy industry. They have gone up a factor of 4. That's a lot. Nobody runs a factor of 4 or moves a factor of 4 faster. It's automized and digitized. Factor of 3, second from the top, is råvarunäringar, mines, power, forest, that type. You know, people with chainsaws, that type of thing, long gone. Mines, we saw that. Instead of him, we have her. What do we have at the bottom? What do we have that has improved, I don't know, 1% in 350 years? Lund University. 350 years old last year. We have the same business model. The idea is for people to move to Lund, and once they arrive in Lund, they listen to people like me doing PowerPoints, the same PowerPoints I've been doing since 1987. We have not had much of productivity increase. The bottom one is public authorities put together. So that percent is the Swedish tax office. That's the only improvement we have. You are also there. The care system is there. In a world that goes like that, you and me, the universities, believe we can stay here. I showed this in Lund to some colleagues. It did not go very well. This is what happened. This ended like this. We have been here for 350 years, and we will be here for 350 more. We're a very conservative system. We do not believe in change. People have been coming to us for 350 years, and they have to continue. That's our ID. Christer, would you stand up for a second? You don't need to come here, just stand up. This guy and many others work with distance education. You have these massive open online courses nowadays. So he can deliver the same thing that I can deliver, but we don't have to move to Lund. Thank you, Christer. What he cannot do today, he cannot sign the degree. Only I can do that. When he gets the right to sign the degree, or he gets a friend that signs for him, we're toast. If Google, you know Google, Google is the world's most attractive employer. When they start the university giving out degrees and promise that the 1,000 best every year will get a job at Google, whoever at that time comes to Lund, we don't want, because they're not as they should be. Why would anybody go to Lund at that time? So we are in for a very, very tough period. It's a bit different for you, because you have patients, and they don't have a Christer. They don't have a Christer with a friend that will sign. So we're in for a tough ride. You may or you may not be. Things go very quickly. The development of knowledge and the development of technology is exponential. This means that if your father was making shoes in the 1500s, you would also be making shoes, it turns out. In your career, during your career, at the best, a new hammer arrives. And then you learn how to use this hammer, and you're fine. That's it. This is the business idea that we have at the universities. We take young, brilliant people, we educate them from one level to the next, and given that education, they're supposed to last a lifetime. When I was working at the Engineering Academy, because I'm an IT professor, I wanted to discuss with them what will the internet be used for and where will it go. They were 20 to 25. I took them in, I had a meeting, I asked them, so what do you think? And they say, we don't know that, we're too old. You have to bring in people that are 15. Imagine that you feel too old when you're 25. You've already unable to keep up. Technology goes really fast. Yeah, I need to make that point deeper. Peter, I need you. This one I will need later to get up. Stand there. You and I will be on the same team, and then we need some people that are brilliant. The two of you, come with me. You'll be on the other team. So stand over there and look intelligent and serious. No. Whoop, over there. Distance. More. Good. Stay. So we now have the situation that you are all entrepreneurs. And you're going to hire two people. Yeah. You see where this is going, don't you? You have two options. You can hire us. This is the paramount chief over here. He's very important. He has a CV that is, like this. If I print my CV, I can sit on it. It's quite long. Or you can take these two that don't know anything. They're just fresh of whatever education they happen to take. Still, strangely enough, most of you would choose them. This is really strange. If you look at that timeline, in the 1500s, everybody would choose the master and nobody would choose the apprentice. Today, everybody chooses the apprentice and nobody chooses the master. This is strange. Something has happened in all of you that was not there in your ancestors. You all assume that because we are, let's call it experienced. Yes. Yeah, experienced. We have not been able to keep up. And you will assume, just because they are young, that they are up to date. This changed around 1950 or so. Before that, people chose the master and not the apprentice. And from the 60s, 70s and on, people choose the apprentice and not the master. Based on the assumption that this goes so fast. This has many implications. A, Peter and I, we would love to be chosen. And what do we need to do to be chosen? And B, when they get more experienced, let's call it, what should they have done meanwhile to stay up to date? Thank you. Håll i den en sekund så kan jag bara ta mig tillbaka. The world is changing. You have changed. That's a part of the world changing, that you have changed. You don't see the world the same way as people used to. And this is problematic. Okay, what does all of this lead to? If you shorten it and pack it a bit, it leads to rising income disparity. The world is torn apart into people that are no longer included, or even worse, that are never getting in. This is from World Economic Forum, rising income disparity. You see one big fat red line in the whole thing, profound social instability. What is profound social instability? It's Donald Trump, the Brazilian Bolsonaro, Hungary, Poland, Romania, Turkey, Sverigedemokraterna, Putin, etc. Many people think that there is some sort of virus or atmosphere or something going around the globe, changing globe. No, it's not. It's a techno-economical revolution. It's an industrial revolution. It's global. It changes everything everywhere. It's not a coincidence that these things are happening. It's a reflection of our inability to deal with this. It's a reflection of that you choose them over us. It's a reflection of our inability to adapt new technology and make something useful of it. In the fall of 2014, there was a lot of research coming out in Sweden trying to reflect the election, the result in the election. We took those, and because, well, if you're a professor, you do that, you cannot help it, we made it into an equation. And into that equation, we put various economies. We put in France and we saw, oh shit, something's going to happen, Macron. We put in the US and we saw there will be two presidential candidates, one that is like a fascist and one that is more socialist, Donald Trump and Bernie Sanders. We predicted Trump 2 years before Trump. We did not believe in the math, I admit that, but I used it as a stage material. So I talked about Trump 2 years before Trump. Among others, for 600 of your colleagues from Region Skåne, I remember. So, if you go a bit deeper, after Trump was elected, 2016, there was a new wave of research. And they looked, for instance, at where do people live? And then you see this map. People living in big cities and university cities, they voted for Clinton, and people living in the rural areas voted for Trump. So you think, okay, everybody, it's a problem with city towards the rural, urban, rural, etc. But if you dig a bit deeper, it will not help moving all of these people there. It's not the zip code that makes you vote this or that way. When they interviewed people, it turns out that the people that believe in the future, the people that says, if you ask them, do you think your children will get a better life than you have? If you say yes, you voted for Clinton. Say no, you voted for Trump. The American middle class outside the major cities have lost the faith in the future. They don't no longer trust in the future. How do we create hope? We have to. Of course, being Swede, you then think, oh shit, this can never happen here. I know Peter Kadhammar at Aftonbladet a little bit. So I asked him, I had lunch with him a year ago, and he said, if you want to, I can check. And I said, yes, please do, because they have this INISO, this institute. He did check. It turns out that 59% of the Swedes think that it's going to get worse, that their children will have a worse life than they have. I thought it would be like 19 or so, not 59. In addition, he validates the theory. The people that votes for Sverigedemokraterna, which is our sort of version of Trump, are the most pessimistic. 90% of those believe that the children will get a worse life. And the most positive in Sweden is Centerpartister. It used to be the Farmers' Party. Only 40% thinks it's going to get worse. And then you think, ah, it's just one thing, right? It could be wrong. It could be wrong. Stockholm Chamber of Commerce do the same thing. It's not formulated in percentage in the same way, but do you think the children will get better or worse life? You see that there is more people here. There are more people on the negative side than on the positive. This is for real, even here. We have the same situation as France. We have a large part of the population that have lost confidence in the system and that could vote for new solutions that come up, a new party or whatever, like Macron. Most of them don't want to go into the, like Le Pen, Sverigedemokraterna, etc., because they don't feel like that, but there's a lot of mass. So we have a situation where people have lost confidence in politics, in society. What do these think are important? They say care is the single most important area. So one, why should we care about care? We should care about care because care is important for people, and we should care about care if we care about democracy. We have 4 years to the next election in Sweden. If we do not roll out the care of the future, say in 3 years or so, we will be in trouble. If you want to roll out the care of the future, where should you go? You should choose Peter. They're good here. It's probably the world's foremost center for e-health. So there's a good chance that here is the place where the future care will be rolled out, and for sure it has to be, here or somewhere. So if you care about democracy also, which I assume you do, this is becoming more important than just your own business. You're not here only for your own sake. You have a larger mission. So we have to solve two things. This, you know that demography next to math is the only exact science. You need a nuclear bomb to change any of this. Otherwise, it always comes out the same way. You can predict it exactly. We have to solve this, and we have to solve that. These are the two challenges. And what tools do we have? We only have technology. Niklas there, or Peter there, or can be very smart and invent new processes, etc. You shuffle a bit, it becomes a bit better. But you cannot make radical differences. You have to use technology. Fortunately, we have an abundance of technology available, and it goes really, really fast. So fast that most of us cannot keep up. So somehow we have to use this to solve the other two. This, staying down here, you may have been doing for, in your case, only 100 years, but in my case, 350 years. It's no longer okay. We can't do that. We have to get better. To solve the two challenges, we have to rise here with technology. I was talking, actually one of these conferences where I predicted Trump 2 years behind Trump. I was in Skåne, in a big sports arena with, I think, the 600 top managers. Top of the top, she's a woman. Second to the top is a man. And this man, just before I'm going to give my presentation, somebody else, some poor guy, had given a presentation, and he says, there are certain things we can never change. We have that have been here for a long time. We know, blah, 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 blah. On a conference about innovation, and I thought, shit, I can just leave. This is hopeless. If the next to the biggest boss says that we can, you know, we can't change things, then we have been developing technology for 2.5 million years, long before we became humans. The only thing we know from this is that we can never say never. With this, take any point in time, and the technology that were to come, it would be magic, amazing. We will achieve amazing things. We may not know the details, but things will change. But this is a problem in the care sector. top management is usually terrible, terrible. We have these needs, and then you have, even from the top manager, I feel like, no. Let's play it safe. This is one of the problems. I lost the clicker. The care system does many, many things. I talk a lot with care staff, and many of them say, no, we cannot use technology because we have to have time to talk to people. This is the most common phrase. The care system produces two things, and both are very important. One is care, and the other is social contact. Loneliness is one of the bigger problems in society today. And, you know, curing loneliness, or at least making a bit better, is important. But the care system confuses these two things. Social contact to cure loneliness should not be automized. Perhaps it can, but it should not. But care should. You and I are sick, Niklas. Not really sick, just, okay, you know. A little bit sick, right? And you're just sick, and Peter there can fix you. I am sick and I'm lonely. In your case, you could be fixed without seeing Peter. You know, you just want to get well. You don't want to go and talk, etc. But I don't want it that way. I want social contact. And today the system is adapted for me. And because I say I want to talk to people, and you're a busy guy, you have to get the care I want. Although you would be better off with a modern version. So today the care is not, the care has many different types of customers, and it's not adapted for them. Another thing you hear is that, oh, the patients do not want anything to change. But the patients want everything to change. When I talk to Peter often talks about the costs of this and the costs of that. And amazingly enough, he only talks about his costs. He doesn't understand why Kry is a good thing. Kry, you know, this is that you Skype with a doctor and everything works out, right? That saves time for me. My costs go down, but his does not. So the costs on a broader level includes many types of costs. The patients want a lot to change because the system is a producing system. It's not patient-centric. It's a factory. So yes, the patients do want things to change. But these two things, if you go out and try to change anything in care, you will meet this. And I expect you already have. So, some basic insight. A, the patients do not want to meet you. They have no interest in meeting you. Maybe socially, over a beer or whatever, but not for care. The patients want to get well. They want to go to one of the unmanned health centers here in the north, put their finger in the machine, take a drop of blood, get a pill coming out from a wall, go home and get well. They do not want to meet anybody. When I worked at the academy, you have this network of fellows. They are very, very smart. They are fellows for life, so the average age of a fellow of the engineering academy is quite high. I understood from meeting them that they are never going to accept somebody 18 coming and cleaning them, showering them, etc. Because it will tear down their integrity. And their integrity was worth more for them than anything else. And they had money, they have money, they have knowledge, and they have networks. They will buy things. They will become cyborgs. Whatever is needed to maintain their integrity. Patients prefer machines over people. Because I'm nearsighted, I have 3 diopters. Does anybody have stronger? But you don't have your glasses on. I need somebody with really strong glasses. No? Okay, I'll take off my glasses. We need to, no, don't leave me. So we need to walk over here. Yeah. And now I cannot read anything. What's the time, for instance? Could you tell me?
2:15.
Okay, I have 15 minutes to go. Now I am sick. I am disabled because I don't have my glasses. I could, of course, walk around with Niklas all day. A human. And many think I would prefer a human over technology, my glasses over there. I don't. You're a nice guy, but go back and sit there. And lead me to my glasses. I need the glasses to find the glasses. 9 times out of 10, you prefer technology over humans. My parents are getting old. They live at home. They can almost not live there any longer because they can't, you know, clean. And if my father falls, and he's a big guy, much bigger than I am, nobody can get him up. So he will not be able to stay at home for much longer because he cannot get himself up. If there was a machine there that would help him, he could live there for another 5 years, maybe. That's much better than somebody going there. And if he had a machine, he would be a bit of a cyborg, but he would have his integrity. And integrity is important. So technology will also change the border between sick and healthy. If I can surround myself with technology, say that I would lose my legs. If I get an exoskeleton, so I get as sporty as I've never been, I would suddenly be healthy. So the difference between sick and healthy changes. Healthy meaning that I can fully function. Information, you know, I have studied a lot of information theory. This one is my favorite. So I am now a doctor. Niklas here, we've taken some tests, etc. We want to tell the results. I call, this still happens, it's become better, but it's still. I call Niklas and say, I have your test results. Come and get them. So he has to sit in his car, he has to drive 200 kilometers, he comes to me and I says, it was perfectly fine. And he goes like, what the fuck? He has had this anxiety, fear of death, for 2 hours, thinking that this is so serious that he can't even tell me face to face. And then it's like, yeah, it's fine. You can go. Information has no mass. You can move information without moving mass. This is an insight that the care system hasn't gotten. This is one of the miracles of these unmanned health rooms. You get there and sensors, they're called sensors in my world, produce information. And then nobody drives there and collects this information and drives it back. It's not milk. It moves. You can move information without moving mass. And this is amazingly, it's much better up here, but in Stockholm, this really happens. They call you and you get there and you're nervous. And then they say, everything is fine. And you're like, why the hell didn't you tell me? And they're like, no, we don't do that. We have to do it face to face. But then Skype, whatever. Care today is like, it's the same business model as the university. Care takes place within 4 walls. It has a start and a stop time. People get sick. They come in within the 4 walls. They get treated. They get well. So care is confined in space, at least that's the mental model, and in time. In a future, it's not going to be like that. Care and well-being will merge, so care will be distributed over time, and it will not be here. It's in 4 rooms because it's convenient for the caregivers. It's really inconvenient for the caretakers. Care will be given when you're at home, when you're at work, because you may not always want to work, but many do. So you can work while you're still sick or receiving care. Care will be given in transit between these environments. So the care of the future looks different, organized different than today. I'm a telecommunications professor. I know a lot about 5G, for instance. What will 5G bring that not 2G or 3G or 4G has brought? All of these has given you, they have given you more capacity. Right? 5G is not about that. 5G will give you more capacity, too, just to make you happy. But there are two other things that are really important. One is reach. 5G will give coverage in rural areas. You can safely and securely, with guarantees, connect medical equipment. We can take his unmanned health room, connect it to me, and I can walk around and it will work. 5G will do another, a second very good thing, and it's it has a service structure. Every other mobile network has given you best effort traffic, which is excellent if you want to email them or, you know, watch YouTube. But if you want to control medical equipment, say that when my father has fallen and my mother, she has a bit of a drinking problem, so she's out of business, I need to control this robot to get my father up. Can I do that over best effort? Maybe, maybe not. I could hit him. I don't know, because there are no guarantees. But 5G will give you guarantees. You can order the connection that has guarantees. And you know you can control this with virtual reality glasses, and you can do it as if you were there. You can put on gloves and you can feel as if you were there. So 5G brings things that are a miracle for care. It can give you remote presence in a way. You could do it today if you're lucky over 4G. If you're the only one in the system, so the system is empty, then your traffic goes, whew, everything is perfect. But then some kid starts YouTubing. We have an example. This guy, this is from South Korea. This guy has an old gaming PC, but the gaming PC doesn't understand that it's old. So it has a 10 megabit interface, and this guy starts an old game. The old game updates. An update goes so that you open a number of TCP streams, so as many as you can, like 25. It's like 25 connections, and then you call for a lot of traffic. And then there's some very modern server at the other end with, you know, 10 gigs of bit pipe. It pushes out traffic that is not consumed, because this is very slow. And what happens with the traffic? It's stored in the router at home, and then that's full, because it's consumed very slowly. Then it fills the router in the Telia network that is close. Then it fills a Stockholm router, and then it fills a national router. Not for very long, because then it's dropped. But for long enough for your medical traffic to go, which is bad. This has been solved, or will be solved with 5G. It's a good technology for care. A lot of things that we could not do before, we will be able to do soon. Did I? Yes. That's. So, for you all to be very comfortable, let's take a long-term perspective. In case of you, I guess there are some bosses here. In 100 years from now, what will care look like? And we know amazingly much. Because by then, all of these little problems are gone and the technological trends have become reality. So in 100 years, we know that we will have artificial intelligence, we will have data-driven processes, so it's not, you call it patient-centric, I call it data-centric. The data coming from me will govern my care. That is Cognitoi. It's the only publicly available interface for Watson, you know, IBM's doctor, etc. It's very clever, actually. I had the Archbishop and her husband at home for dinner, and I wanted to demonstrate, you know, we can create artificial life today, as a living processes from non-living materials. I had a professor doing that, and then I demonstrated AI, the best we have. So we know that in 100 years from now, there will be many decisions made by machines, etc., and made before we meet any Peter. We will have a whole lot of sensors. Everything will be measured. Everything about me. I will know that in 14 and a half hours from now, I'll get sick if I don't do this or that. We will know a lot. We will have, of course, patient-centric care, because by then all of this production mentality is gone and everything is around me, me, and me. And this care and well-being, if I ever get sick, I will know it in advance and it will be integrated. So well-being and care is one thing. It's not this limited in time. And then we will have lots of cyborg stuff. If there is anything I don't like with me, I will augment me so I get better. I think in 100 years from now, you can agree that this will be the case. By then, all of this will have had time to happen. Let's take a different time perspective, 50 years. It's the same text, I just took away the cognito. In 50 years from now, I think you agree all of this will have played out. 50 years is a long time. 5G will be an ancient technology by then. All of these things will have happened. 20 years from now. Now it gets interesting. Do you not agree that these things will have happened? If they all have happened, and I think most of them will, it will be recent. It will be around that perspective. 20 years from now, most of these things will have played out. Problem with that is that in 20 years from now, I will still be working. And so will you. If these things are to be implemented 20 years from now, it will be us. We cannot delegate it. And if we realize that we are the ones that have to do this, we could either wait, which a lot of people do. My wife is Spanish, they have a lot of waiting. Or we can just get on with it. If we agree that it's around 20 years from now, and I think you cannot argue a lot with that, you also agree that you're the ones that have to do it. And if you're the ones that have to do it, what the hell are you waiting for? Do you think there will be bättre tider around the corner? Do you think Henrik here will arrive from the government, will give you the gadgets and the processes? He's a PowerPoint man, he's not gonna do that. I work a lot with politicians, a lot. Stefan and Ulla Löfven cooked dinner for me in Sagerska. I know a lot of them. They're great, all of them. But the solutions are not going to come from there. You can't delegate this. There is nobody you can delegate this to. And if you don't, you get this, right? Thank you.